This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. And good morning. Welcome to our service of worship and praise this Palm Sunday. Our service today begins with a procession of palms by the children of our church and school. And they then, with the choir, will sing our opening anthem, Hosanna to the King. God bless your worship with us today. We follow the order of service as you see it in your worship folder. We continue with the invocation and the opening responses. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming King.
Hosanna to the highest heaven.
O Lord, with the Palm Sunday crowd, we cry to you. Save us, for we have sinned against you in thought and word and deed.
Save us, for we have sinned against you by what we have done and by what we have left.
Save us, for we have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Jesus Christ became obedient unto death, even death on a cross, so that through faith in him you could receive life and salvation. His name is above every name. In his name I forgive your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. We have come to join that crowd praising you, O Lord, in your triumphant procession to the cross of Calvary. Bless us as we contemplate again what you've done for us. Today's first reading for Palm Sunday is taken from Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 through 10. This prophecy from Zechariah about Jesus, of course, obviously was fulfilled on Palm Sunday. We read, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion, shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth." This is the word of our Lord. Blessed are they who hear God's word and live by it. Amen. Our psalm for this Palm Sunday is Psalm 24, where we welcome the King. You'll see that psalm printed in your worship folder and on the screen. It begins with the refrain, followed by the verses, and the refrain is sung after each verse. Mm-hmm. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11 is our second reading for today. See how humble your King is for you. St. Paul writes, "In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." We continue with our next hymn, Ride On in Majesty. To the immortal, invisible, only wise God, be honor and praise and glory forever and ever. Amen. And the word of God for our meditation on this Palm Sunday is taken from John chapter 12, verses 12 through 19. You will see those verses in your worship folder tonight, and I'll read them as we go through our sermon for today. In Jesus' name, that King Almighty, that King of Kings and Lord of Lords, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ. Every Sunday, the Sunday the week before Easter, we take this journey with Jesus, don't we? It starts out in the little village of Bethany. You see it on the lower right-hand side of the screen. That little village about 2 miles southeast of Jerusalem on the other side of that great big hill called the Mount of Olives. And then we continue from Bethany down that well-worn road that skirts the Mount of Olives till we get to an even smaller village called Bethphage. And from there, at Bethphage, we get our first glance of the holy city of Jerusalem. 1 square mile, crowded with people at the time of the Passover. And it's dominated by the walls and the courts and the gates and the buildings of that temple complex. And after we've gazed at that temple for a bit, then we continue down that well-worn road that skirts the Mount of Olives, past the Garden of Gethsemane, down into the Kidron Valley, and then up the other side of the Kidron Valley, where we enter into one of the gates of the city of Jerusalem. We make that journey every year on Palm Sunday. And so you could say that we have our own place in that Palm Sunday crowd. But where do you fit in? See, arguably, you could say that there were three separate and identifiable crowds that were there on Palm Sunday. And that's why our theme for this morning says, what's your place in that Palm Sunday crowd? Is it with the people from Jerusalem who were jealous of Jesus? Is it with the people from Galilee who were praising Jesus? Is it with the people of Bethany who are confident in Christ Jesus? Or is it a combination of all three? Well, that's what we'll find out today. So I'm going to read through this familiar account from John chapter 12 and make a few comments along the way. It starts out this way: the next day, and that's the day after the sister of Lazarus, remember her name, Mary, she anointed Jesus' feet with some really precious perfume. Well, it was the day after that that the great crowd that had come for the Passover festival, they heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. Now, this crowd was probably from all over the land of Israel, but most of them, I'm thinking, were from up north in Galilee, where they had gotten to know Jesus and love Jesus for the past couple of years. And here's what it says about this crowd from Galilee. They took palm branches and they went out to meet him. And these palm branches were typically, 9 feet long, a lot longer than our palm branches, from the tops of these date palm trees. Some of these date palm trees grew to be 90 feet tall. And obviously, you could find them on the Mount of Olives where Jesus was walking. In that day, they probably used these 9-foot-long palm branches for thatching on their roofs, maybe for making fences to keep their animals in. But on this day, of course, they used these palm branches to honor Jesus, to welcome Jesus. Going on, we learn more about this crowd. They were shouting, "Hosanna," which literally means in Hebrew, "Save us now." And by the way, that's a direct quote from Psalm 118. They shouted, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." That too is a direct quote from Psalm 118. And with those words, they were identifying Jesus as coming from the Lord himself, that he was an ambassador from God. And they shouted, "Blessed is the King of Israel." And really, with those words, they were identifying Jesus as God. Going on, Jesus found a young donkey, and he sat upon it. As it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." And why would Jesus ride on a donkey or even a donkey's colt? Does it help to think about it this way? When a person rides on a horse, they come with the intention of claiming a victory, perhaps, of conquering by their own power. When a person rides on a tiny little donkey, their intention is to bring peace by way of their own gentleness. And so the daughter of Zion, that would be the people of Jerusalem, had nothing to fear, nothing at all, from this king, King Jesus, just like Zechariah had prophesied 600 years earlier. Let's go on. At first, his disciples did not understand all this. They didn't understand that what they were witnessing that day was a fulfillment of Psalm 118, and that it was a fulfillment of Zechariah chapter 9. They didn't get that. Only after Jesus was glorified, risen from the dead, after he had sent the Holy Spirit to his disciples, just as he promised, to inform them, instruct them, but most of all inspire them, only then did they realize that these things that were happening on Palm Sunday had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. So that's the basic account from John's Gospel of Palm Sunday. But and then, interestingly enough, John adds some more details about two other crowds that were present that day. Here. Now, the crowd that was with him, Jesus, when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead, continued to spread the word. You understand what that's saying? That great big crowd from up north in Galilee who had gotten to know Jesus over the years, who were welcoming Jesus with their palms and singing Jesus their psalms, that big group from Galilee was now being informed by that smaller crowd from Bethany about the great miracle that Jesus had performed in raising Lazarus from the dead. And as a result, many people, because they had heard that he had performed that sign, that miracle, went out to meet him. So I've mentioned to you the two crowds. The great big one from up north in Galilee, the smaller crowd from the city or village of Bethany, and there's a third crowd. It's much more sinister. So the Pharisees said to one another, "See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him." You know that the Pharisees had long been jealous of Jesus. Before Jesus came along, people had looked up to the Pharisees. But not so much anymore. Now, more and more, they were looking up to Jesus. And this really agitated those Pharisees. They couldn't stand it. "Look how the whole world has gone after him," they lamented. And they exaggerated too. These Pharisees never would have dreamed that in just 5 days, they would have this Jesus dead, nailed to a cross. And the Pharisees never would have dreamed that in 7 days, this same Jesus would rise from the dead, so that all this that was taking place on Palm Sunday was, in effect, Jesus' victory parade 1 week in advance. And of course, these Pharisees never would have dreamed, they never would have imagined that this Jesus, by his death and his resurrection, would rescue the whole world. That people from the whole world would end up following him. People from the whole world would go after him. So that's John's eyewitness account of the events of Palm Sunday. As we've seen, he identified three separate crowds, three separate groups that were there. So I'll ask it again, where do you fit in? What crowd are you a member of? What crowd are you a part of? Could it be the Pharisees that were jealous of Jesus? My brothers and sisters, I think we have to say yes to that question. And you're thinking, us? Me? Jealous of Jesus? Pastor, you got to be kidding. I would never be jealous of Jesus, but I'm not kidding. And I urge you, every one of you, to take an honest look at yourself, to look inside of yourself and at your sinful nature. That sinful nature of yours is jealous of Jesus. And here's what I mean. Jesus claims the absolute right to give me orders in my life. But my sinful nature proudly says, no, no one's going to order me around. Jesus claims that he has done absolutely everything necessary for my salvation. But my sinful nature proudly and jealously says, no, I can contribute toward my salvation. Jesus tells me that when it comes to spiritual matters, I have nothing whatsoever to boast about or brag about before him. And my sinful nature proudly says, no, that can't be. And Jesus tells me that he has redeemed me with his own blood, that I can serve as his eager servant forever. And this sinful nature of mine selfishly, jealously, proudly, stubbornly says no. No one's going to make me their servant or their slave. And sadly, your sinful nature says the same. So that was one crowd that was there that day, the Pharisees. But there was a second crowd, those from up north in Galilee, those who shouted as Jesus rode along, Hosanna, save us now. They shouted, you are the God's own ambassador. You are the Lord our King. They brought Jesus their palm branches. They praised Jesus with their psalms. Are you a part of that crowd? By God's grace, you are. And then some. See, humbly, peacefully, gently, Jesus has ridden into your hearts. Not on the back of a donkey, of course. He's ridden into your hearts by way of his beautiful gospel message. With just a little handful of water, he has washed away your pride, your selfishness, your jealousy, your stubbornness forever, and made you a member of God's own family. With a little bite of bread and a little sip of wine, he comes to you and he says to you, I am yours and you are mine. And that's the way it will be forever. And even right now, this very moment, by way of his word, it's Jesus who is whispering into your ears, peace, my peace, God's peace, a perpetual peace, the peace of paradise. You have found it in me. You have found it in me. And so no wonder we shout to him today, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Lord, you are our ambassador from God, and we welcome you. Lord, you are our Lord and King, and we praise you, and we honor you, and we extol you, and we adore you. And what do? We bring him our palms. We bring him our greens. What do I mean by that? Well, for you children here, maybe you bring Jesus your Washington greens or your Lincoln greens or your Andrew Jackson greens. For you older people here, you bring Jesus your Ulysses S. Grant greens and your Benjamin Franklin greens and maybe even bigger greens than that. And we lay them down at Jesus' feet to honor him, to thank him for what he has done for us, and so that he can ride into the hearts of others with his gospel. And not only do we lay down our palms, our greens before him, but we sing him our psalms. We sing him our praises. And what do those praises sound like? Do they sound like this? Hosanna, soft Hosanna, the little children whisper. No, they sound like this, Hosanna, loud Hosanna, the little children and the great big adults sing. Do our praises sound like this? Ride on in misery. No, we sing, ride on, O Lord, in majesty. Remember, this is the one who has bought you, redeemed you with his own blood. This is the one who promises to take you to glory forever. Sing loud to him. He deserves it. And that's especially true when you think about what that third crowd knew about Jesus. This was the crowd from Bethany that had seen Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead. Are you a part of that crowd? In this sense, you are. You soberly recognize that one day you are going to die. With just as much sober recognition, you recognize that you're not going to be able to raise yourself from the dead. But you know the one who said, little girl, I say to you, get up. And you know the one who once said, young man, I say to you, arise. And you know the one who shouted, Lazarus, come out. And above all, you know the one who was stone cold dead, but then raised himself to life again and said to you, because I live, you also will live. And you know what? We have a way of honoring that person in the next several days. On Thursday of this week, and then Friday of this week, and then twice on Sunday this next week. Let's be here for those days to honor him. Let's be here for thousands of days afterwards. Amen. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please join me now as we confess our Christian faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, seeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. At this time, we present our offerings to the Lord. Please join me now in the responsive prayer of God's people. Lord Jesus, you are the King of heaven and earth. We join the First Palm Sunday worshipers in praising and glorifying you for coming to this earth to be our Savior. Thanks be to you for living a life of perfect conformity to God's holy law in our place. Cause our voices to blend with those who sang your praises as you rode into Jerusalem, and move us to confess you before others as our Lord. Use us to assure all people that your blood has cleansed them from sin and set them free from slavery to sin, death, and the devil. Hear us, Lord, as we bring to you our private petitions. Dear Savior, as we walk with you this week toward Calvary, keep us focused on your purpose for coming into this world and on our calling to spread this wonderful message of salvation. Hear us for your mercy's sake. In your name, we join in praying. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We continue with our communion liturgy. Our guests are encouraged to read our announcement about the Lord's Supper on the next page of our bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is good and right and a joyful thing to always and everywhere give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For our sins he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. By his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever proclaim the glory of your name. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant that is poured out for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Amen and amen. You may come forward as directed by our ushers. We will start with the outside sections here and here. Remember to exit toward the windows, come up by that side aisle and receive the bread and wine, and then return by this other side aisle back to your pew. And then when those two sections are done, we'll do the same thing with these sections. Exit toward the window, receive the bread and wine, and then return by the main aisle. Savior Jesus Christ. Take and drink the blood of your Savior Jesus Christ. is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Take and drink the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Take and drink. This is the blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Take and drink. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Take and drink the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. 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 Could you tell Meg that I think we're going to run out of wine? This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Can you wait just a minute? I've got to get more wine. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Lord and your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Take and eat the body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And take and drink the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. This body and blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, will strengthen you, and it will preserve you in the one true faith unto life everlasting. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. We continue with a thank the Lord.
Thank you.
We praise you, Almighty God, for your love. We remember how your Son entered Jerusalem as a king. Help us all to know, believe, and live in his victory. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
Our closing hymn, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. Good morning. Seems there should be a fancier greeting for Palm Sunday, but good morning we'll have to do. Nice to see you all here. Welcome to our visitors, especially if you brought a child to sing for our service today. We thank you for that. We pray that your time with us was a blessing to you. We thank their teachers. We thank the accompanists as well and our choir members for beautifying our service in that way. So here are our announcements. First, there will be Sunday school and Bible class today as usual. Sunday school children meet down in the gym. And for Bible class, continuing in the book of Romans, we meet in the fellowship hall. Here is our Holy Week schedule. I alluded to it in the sermon. Thursday, Holy Thursday, 6:30 service with communion. And then Friday, Good Friday, 6:30 service, service of darkness, of tenebrae. You're all invited to that. We have two services on Sunday. They're different from each other. The first service is our song service. We'll celebrate the Lord's Supper in that service. And then that's at 7. Then there's a break for an Easter breakfast down at the gym. And then we have our festival service at 9 o'clock. You're invited for all of those and invite your friends and neighbors and acquaintances to come to those as well. The palms that the children brought in today will be distributed to you. If anyone wants to take a palm, they are welcome to them. I think they'll be given out after the service. Somebody put a note on the altar, but is that right? No one's going to own up to that note, Meg? Okay, you'll do that, or someone will do that. Fantastic. A couple of weeks ago, there was a fundraiser to help the Pioneer, or by the Pioneers, and they funding their Lutheran Pioneer group, but they also wanted to donate a part of their proceeds to the sign project that we have here. We're going to have a sign out here along the road that goes behind our church. And to make that presentation, I would invite Kira Brooks, who is a member of the Lutheran Pioneers, and Larry Enter, who is a member of the Outreach Committee. Oh, I'm sorry, Gary Hosha, a member of the Outreach Committee. Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Kira. So, oh, Meg? Sunday school students get their palms at Sunday school. Thank you. You know that we have sort of adopted Carly Beck as our sort of community baby here at Mount Olive. She suffered a really, really severe setback last night. And her parents, Jeannie and Mike, sent this to be read to their Mount Olive family. As you know, Carly has been hospitalized at Children's Minnesota, recovering from her heart surgery. We have had many ups and downs, and we were so excited to be on the road towards bringing Carly home. However, last night around 9:30, Carly flatlined and had to be resuscitated twice. They were able to get her heartbeat back, but she had no pulse and had to be placed back on life support. She is currently stable and fully sedated while recovering from this episode. Right now, we are waiting for more answers and we don't have a whole lot of additional information. However, we appreciate your love, your support, and your prayers. With love, Mike and Jeannie. And with that in mind, let's pray for them, shall we? We pray. Heavenly Father, we once again come before your throne of grace on behalf of your precious daughter, Carly Beck. We thank you for sparing her life last night, and we implore you to keep her alive and put her on the path to full health. Be with Carly, reminding her of your powerful presence and taking away any fear she may be experiencing. Be with Mike and Jeannie as well, reminding them of your love for them and Carly, and that in that love, you only intend blessing upon blessing for this family. Answer our prayers for Carly, dear Lord, for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Yes, any extra prayers, obviously, are going to be greatly appreciated by the family. If there are more updates, you probably will be able to find them on Carly's Caring Bridge site. Before you leave, say hello to your fellow worshipers all around you. Maybe introduce yourself to them if you don't know them. Get to know them better. I'll greet you in the entryway.